My dear students, in today's class, we shall study about the phylum Annelida and then we shall proceed up to Echinodermata. The members of the phylum Annelida, they have rings on their body, hence the name Annelida. Annelida here refers to the animals with the annuli. Annuli refers to rings. The members may be aquatic, marine or freshwater. Neris is an example for marine form. And leech is the example for freshwater. So, annelids may be aquatic, marine like neris, or freshwater like leeches. They may be terrestrial. Earthworm is an example for terrestrial annelid. They may be free living. Neris and earthworm both are examples for free living. And sometimes they may be parasitic like leeches. So, you must know which are the examples for marine, which are the examples for freshwater, which are the examples for terrestrial, which are the examples for free living, and also which is the example for parasitic. This is the diagram of the Neris. Neris is also otherwise called Neanthus. N-E-A-N-T-H-E-S. Neanthus. So, Neris or Neanthus is a marine form. Earthworm is a terrestrial form. It is a terrestrial one. Leech is the freshwater form. There are some species of leeches which occur on land also. They are quite small. What you see here, this is the cattle leech. It is a big one, which is about 10 to sometimes 15 centimeter long when it is stretched. Annelids exhibit organ system level of body organization. You know what means organ system level body organization? And they show bilateral symmetry. You can cut the body into two equal halves along one plane of division. They are triploblastic with ectoderm, mesoderm and endoderm, metamerically segmented and coelomate animals. Metamerically segmented. You see on the outer surface of the body, the grooves, and corresponding to the grooves on the inner side, you come across the septa. The animals which are segmented both externally and internally are known as metamerically segmented animals. And they are coelomate animals. We have here body cavity lined on both the sides by the mesoderm. So, right from Annelida up to the Echinodermata, whatever you are studying, then all chordates are coelomate animals. The body surface of annelids is distinctly marked out into segments. That is what I said, metamerically segmented. All these are segments. Segments are otherwise called metameres. And this term metamere is derived from a Latin language. Annulus means little ring. Since these animals bear little rings on their body surface, they are called annelids and the phylum name is Annelida. This is the figure that you see in your NCERT book. This is the Neris. You can see here in this particular picture, what you see at the sides, these are all parapodia. These are called parapodia. They are lateral extensions of the body wall. parapodia, which helps in locomotion. This is the nares, and what you see here, these are all segments, metameres. And this is the diagram of a leech. It is a hirudinaria. It is scientifically called hirudinaria, and you can make out these lines on the body, which indicates the segments. Annelids possess longitudinal as well as circular muscles. You have longitudinal muscles, and also you do come across circular muscles. And because of these longitudinal and circular muscles, the annelids are in a position to crawl on the surface of the land. So they possess longitudinal and circular muscles, which help in locomotion. So these muscles help the animals in locomotion. You might have seen how the earthworm moves on the land. Once it extends its body, then second, it contracts. Again extends, that means it elongates the body, then it shortens the body and becomes widened. In this way, you do come across the movement in case of the annelids, and it is due to the longitudinal and circular muscles. Aquatic annelids like nereids, I have already told you, nereids is seen in seawater. So it is aquatic. Aquatic annelids like nereids possess lateral appendages called parapodia, and these parapodia help in swimming. To a certain extent, they also help in respiration. But mainly, parapodia are used in swimming. This is what you have, the parapodia. This is the nereids. You can see body is with the rings, segments, and at the sides, we come across the parapodia. Individual parapodium is shown here, and at the middle, you see some black structure, and these black structures are called setae, S-E-T-A-E. Setae are the locomotory structures of the annelids. This point is not given in NCERT book. So you have to note down setae, S-E-T-A-E. Setae are the locomotory structures of the members of the phylum Annelida, especially that of nereids and earthworm. Annelids possess closed circulatory system wherein the blood flows inside definite blood vessels. These are the blood vessels inside which the blood flows. So, amongst the invertebrates, it is the annelids and a few members of the phylum Mollusca, they do show closed circulatory system, and other members like that of the Mollusca, Arthropoda, they do show open circulatory system. Only few members of the Mollusca like cephalopod molluscs includes that of the Sepia, Loligo, Octopus, etc. They do show closed circulatory system. Apart from Annelida, some members of the Mollusca also show closed circulatory system. The members of the phylum Arthropoda and that of Mollusca, other molluscs, they do show open circulatory system. Annelids have nephridia as the important organ for osmoregulation and excretion. You can see here somewhat greenish structure, and this greenish structure, whatever you see, that is called nephridium. Nephridium is a singular, nephridia is plural. There are many nephridia. There are three types of nephridia in the body of earthworm. Here, these nephridia help in osmoregulation, in the maintenance of water and salt balance, and also excretion in the removal of nitrogenous waste substance. If you look into this nephridia, you can see here, this is what nephridium, single nephridium. It starts from here. It has a funnel-like structure with an aperture inside, and that is always called nephrostome. And this funnel-like structure, it leads into the duct, very much a coiled duct, and this duct, before opening to the outside, it widens, and this widened part is called a bladder part of the nephridium, and it opens to the outside by an aperture called nephridiopore. So whenever a nephridium has two apertures, one nephrostome, stome refers to mouth, aperture through which excretory matter enters into this nephridium, and another aperture is a nephridiopore. That is the aperture of the nephridium, nephridiopore. Through the nephridiopore, excretory matter comes out. Whatever the excretory matter that collects here, whatever the waste material that collects here, that enters into nephrostome, passes through this duct, gets stored for some time in the bladder-like part, and later it is pushed out through the nephridiopore. Such a nephridium, which has two apertures, one nephrostome and another nephridiopore, is known as metanephridium. So, in case of annelida, we come across nephridium, which is of metanephridium. You have heard about protonephridium. Protonephridium you have seen in the phylum of Platyhelminthes. The members of the phylum Platyhelminthes, especially that of Planaria, they do show what is known as flame cells. Flame cells are otherwise called the protonephridia. So, protonephridia is the one which has only one aperture to send this excretory matter. Metanephridia are the one which have two apertures. One aperture nephrostome to receive the excretory matter, another aperture nephridiopore to pass the excretory matter out. So, coming to the nervous system consists of paired ganglia. You see, paired ganglia in each segment. In each segment, ganglion is a singular, two refers to ganglia. Two ganglia. There are two ganglia in each of the segments which are connected, and these ganglion connected to form nerve cord, and this nerve cord is of double nature. Therefore, we say annelids possess double ventral nerve cord. There are two nerve cords. In each segment, there are two ganglia. And these nerve cords are connected to the brain. So, the nervous system of annelids include a ring-like structure. And this ring-like structure is connected to double ventral nerve cord. Ring-like structure, whatever you come across, it is formed of the dorsal, what is called brain or cerebral ganglion, or it is also called suprapharyngeal ganglion, and ventral one, you come across another ganglion here, which is always called subesophageal ganglion. So, on the upper side, we have brain. Brain is also called cerebral ganglion, or it is also called suprapharyngeal ganglion, or it is also called supraesophageal ganglion. And this brain or cerebral ganglion is connected to sub-esophageal ganglion. Sub means below. Supra means above. This is what you see, esophagus. Above the esophagus, you have supra-esophageal ganglion, or this is also a region of a pharynx. So, pharynx or esophagus. So, it is referred to as supra-pharyngeal or supra-esophageal. Supra means above. Suprapharyngeal or supraesophageal, and down below is a subpharyngeal. Sub means below. Below the esophagus or below the pharynx, subesophageal ganglion. So there is a connecting supraesophageal ganglion with the subesophageal ganglion. Later it continues as a double ventral nerve cord. Each segment possesses a pair of ganglia. So what you have to remember is that in case of annelids, there is a double ventral nerve cord, and it is very much a solid. Solid double ventral nerve cord, and this solid double ventral nerve cord is connected to the brain by means of connectives. Neris, an aquatic form, is a dioecious. In Neris, sexes are separate. So, you see here, one Neris here, and this is the Neris whose posterior part is very much brightly colored during breeding period. During breeding period, you see that posterior part is beautifully colored only during breeding period. So, in case of Neris, sexes are separate. But in earthworms and leeches, the sexes are united, or what we say, earthworms and leeches are hermaphrodites. Earthworms and leeches are bisexual. They are bisexual, or we say they are monoecious. Only Neris is a unisexual, or it is a dioecious, where sexes are separate. Reproduction is a sexual. Reproduction is a sexual. There is no asexual reproduction in annelids. No asexual reproduction. Reproduction is a sexual. This is what the larva you have. The larva is called trochophore larva. Trochophore larva is the larval name of annelids. Annelids possess trochophore larva. Development is indirect. This is what you come across, the reproduction in case of earthworm. It is a mating. And we have already seen these earthworms are bisexual. It is not that of these two earthworms, one is male, another is female. Not like that. Both are bisexual. This one, which is situated on the upper side, it has both the testes and ovary. The one below, this also has a testes and ovary. Both are bisexual, and even though they are bisexual, they do show some sort of cross-fertilization. Here, the sperms from this animal, which is there on the upper side, it passes to the lower animal. The sperms from the lower animal passes to the upper animal. That means these two animals, during mating period, they exchange their sperms. So, this type of fertilization is called reciprocal cross-fertilization. This is a reciprocal cross-fertilization. That means the sperms of one animal goes to the another animal, and sperms of another animal goes to the upper animal. So, there is the exchange of the sperms between the two animals, and this is what is known as reciprocal cross-fertilization. You can also see here, these are the two leeches which also involved in the sexual reproduction. These are the two leeches, but as I told you, both these are hermaphrodites, bisexual. Now let us look into the examples. Examples include Neris, Peritima is the scientific name of earthworm. Hirudinaria is the scientific name of leech. And as you know, leech is a parasite. And a leech is known to suck the blood. It is a blood-sucking parasite, and such a blood-sucking parasites are otherwise called sanguivorous animals. S-A-N-G-U-I-V-O-R-O-U-S. Sanguivorous animals. So, leeches are sanguivores. Sangui. S-A-N-G-U-I-V-O-R-O-U-S. Sanguivorous means blood-sucking parasites. Leeches are sanguivorous animals. So, example, Hirudinaria. Hirudinaria is the scientific name of the leech. So, let us see them again. This is a Neris, commonly called sandworm or clamworm, okay, or this ragworm like that, ragworm like that. So, this is a Neris, and this is a earthworm, right? Peritima. And this is what you have. This is what you have. The leech again. If you look into the leech, you must know that once the leech sucks the blood, it completely gets its alimentary canal completely filled. These are the parts of the alimentary canal. Leech has the alimentary canal with the 10 crop chambers. The crop is the 10 chambers. This part is called crop, and there are 10 chambers. And up to here, the blood gets filled. Once it gets a full meal, leeches can survive for another 1 to 1.5 years without a second meal, without taking the food a second time. So, to suck the blood, it first anesthetizes the part of the host, and it makes somewhat inverted Y-shaped wound. This is what a wound that is made by leech. It has three jaws, one jaw, another jaw, third jaw. With the three jaws, it makes inverted Y-shaped wound. After making inverted Y-shaped wound, it introduces hirudin pigment, which prevents coagulation of the blood, and it starts sucking the blood continuously. And once it starts continuously sucking the blood, it will not leave the body of the host. It remains attached to the body of the host. After it gets a full meal, then only it falls down. Till then, it is always found attached to the body of the host. Now, let us come to the next phylum, that is phylum Arthropoda. Arthros means jointed. Poda refers to legs. So, arthropods possess jointed legs. Arthropoda is the largest phylum in the animal kingdom, which includes mostly insects. So, Arthropoda is the largest phylum. Insecta is the largest class under the phylum Arthropoda. Over 2/3 of all named species on Earth are arthropods. Over 2/3 of all named species out of this animal kingdom, more than two-thirds of the animals so far discovered are from arthropods. Therefore, phylum Arthropoda is the largest phylum in the animal kingdom. And these are the figures pertaining to the Arthropoda. You can make out, this is what you have, grasshopper, locust, and this is a butterfly, and this is a scorpion, and this is what you have, prawn. Prawn is the arthropod which always lives in water. Of course, there are different species. Some of them live in fresh water, and others live in salt water or sea water. So, we have two varieties of prawn. Arthropods show organ system level of body organization. So, we do come across different systems in case of the arthropods, like digestive system, excretory system, circulatory system, nervous system, reproductive system, etc. They are bilaterally symmetrical, triploblastic, segmented, and coelomatinous. I hope you know the meaning of all these terms. The body of arthropods is covered by chitinous exoskeleton. What you see here is the chitinous exoskeleton, and this insect is coming out of the chitinous exoskeleton, and that process is known as ecdysis, or it is also known as molting. They have non-living exoskeleton. Exoskeleton is the one which gives protection to the body. And this exoskeleton is made up of chitin material. Therefore, we call it a chitinous exoskeleton. In arthropods, such as insects, arachnids, these are all classes of arthropoda, insecta, arachnida. Arachnida includes scorpion and spiders. Crustacean, it is another class, aquatic arthropoda. Crustacean includes that of prawn. Molting is the shedding of the exoskeleton. Molting is also known as ecdysis. It is also known as ecdysis. So, what is ecdysis or molting? It is the shedding of the exoskeleton, which is often called its shell, that is shedding of its external shell, typically to let the organism to grow. So, if the exoskeleton is not shed, animal cannot grow. It becomes very tight. Therefore, you might have heard about this shedding, or you might have heard about this molting or ecdysis in case of snakes. Snakes are well known to show this molting or ecdysis. So, arthropods also show this molting or ecdysis. The old exoskeleton is also called XVA. It is called XVA. Therefore, ecdysis is also known as exuviation. It is also called exuviation. So, old exoskeleton is called XVA. The body of arthropod in general consists of head region, thoracic region, and abdomen region. So, the body consists of head, thorax, and abdomen. Now, let us see what is there in head, thorax, and abdomen. So, the arthropods have jointed appendages. We can see here three pairs of appendages. And these appendages, others legs, or with the joints. Hence the name arthropoda. Arthros means a joint, poda refers to appendages. So arthropods, members of phylum arthropoda, they always possess jointed legs, jointed appendages. Hence the name arthropoda. And these appendages are found attached to the thoracic region. They are found attached to the ventral surface of the thorax. The respiratory organs include gills, book lungs, or tracheal system. The respiratory organs are gills. Where you have the gills? Gills are present in prawn like arthropoda. Aquatic arthropods like a prawn, P-R-A-W-N. And these prawns are of two types. There are some prawns which live in fresh water and others live in salt water. The one which lives in salt water is called Pineus, P-E-N-A-E-U-S. And the one which lives in salt fresh water is called Palaemon, P-A-L-A-E-M-O-N. So there are two types of prawns, freshwater forms and marine forms, but both of these possess gills. And we come across what is known as book gills. The book gills are seen in another aquatic arthropod by name Limulus, L-I-M-U-L-U-S. Limulus is also called king crab. It is also called king crab, or also called horseshoe-shaped crab. Horseshoe-shaped crab or king crab. In a king crab or horseshoe-shaped crab, we come across book gills. And in case of scorpion or spiders, we come across book lungs. And in case of insects, we have wind tubes, what you call trachea. So, respiratory organs include gills, as you can see in the prawn. These are the gills. In case of aquatic arthropoda, which belongs to the class Crustacea, or they have what is called a tracheal tube. This is what you see in cockroaches, and these are the tubes that you have, and these tubes are called tracheae in insects, or these include book-like structures, you can see, and these structures which look like a book with the pages there, with the sheets there, therefore these are called book lungs. Book lungs are seen in a scorpion and in spiders, and we have what is called book gills, and these are the gills which have book gills in animal called, this is what is known as a Limulus or horseshoe-shaped crab. The shape is horseshoe-like. Horseshoe-shaped crab, or it is also known as a horseshoe crab, or it is also known as a king crab. Horseshoe crab or king crab, in these we come across what is known as a book gills. Therefore, you must know that the respiratory organs include gills or book lungs or book gills or trachea. Circulatory system is of open type. If you look here, this is of a prawn. There is one heart here, and this from heart, one blood vessel comes, then the blood drains here. Entire body gets filled with the blood. And that type of circulatory system is called open type of blood vessel system. Circulatory system is open type where the blood baths the all organs inside the body, and the blood here is always called hemolymph, H-A-E-M-O-L-Y-M-P-H. Blood is called hemolymph, and the cavity filled with blood is always called cavity, or the space filled with blood is always called hemocele. Heme refers to blood. Seal refers to space. The space filled with the blood is called hemocele. So circulatory system is of open type. Sensory organs include antennae. You can see here many jointed antennae. There are two antennae. Compound eyes. Insects possess compound eyes. Each compound eye, it is called compound eye, because each eye is formed of a number of smaller units called ommatidia. Ommatidium singular, ommatidia plural. What is ommatidium? It is a simple eye. The cockroach eye or insect eye is generally called compound eye. Arthropods in general, they possess a compound eyes. Each eye is formed of simple units called ommatidia. Then also, in aquatic forms, we come across what is called statocyst. Statocysts are balancing organs. And statocysts are present in aquatic arthropods. Therefore, the sensory organs include antennae, compound and simple eyes, or compound eye made up of simple eyes, statocysts. Excretion takes place through minute tubules, hair-like structures, and these hair-like structures are called Malpighian tubules. So, excretion is mainly through Malpighian tubules. Malpighian tubules are hair-like structures. You can make out here nearly 100 and 150 such minute tubules are present, which are present attached to the alimentary canal. It is present between the midgut and hindgut. And these Malpighian tubules help in the excretion. Arthropods are mostly dioecious. They are mostly dioecious. That means sexes are separate. You can easily make out here, this is a male cockroach and this is a female cockroach. Male and female cockroaches. So, sexes are separate. That means they are unisexual. Fertilization, usually internal. You can see there are two cockroaches here. They are found attached by their rear end. And this is what you see, copulation or mating in case of cockroach. So, fertilization is usually internal in case of arthropods. They are mostly egg-laying animals, oviparous. So, at the time of egg-laying, you can see a small structure. What you see here, this is called oothecha. Oothecha. Theca refers to cover. This cover or case contains 16 eggs. 16 eggs. And you can see here, the female carrying that oothecha, and once it comes across the good place with the good humidity and abundant availability of the food, it deposits there. This oothecha is glued onto the wall surface. It is attached to the wall surface and left there. And inside this, you come across nearly 16 eggs, which come out as 16 young ones, which we call a nymph, N-Y-M-P-H. So, arthropods are mostly oviparous. Development may be direct or indirect. So, here, this is butterfly, and this is larva, what you call caterpillar larva, and this larva enters into pupa stage, and from the pupa stage, the adult comes out. So, development may be direct or indirect. Whenever it is indirect, we come across a caterpillar-like larva. Caterpillar-like larva. We also have some other larva. Generally, in a crustacean, like a prawn, that you have a larva called Nauplius larva. N-A-U-P-L-I-U-S. Nauplius larva is the common larva of a crustacea. Crustaceans are aquatic arthropods. Now let us study economically important insects. What you see here is the honeybee. Honeybee, and you can see on its third pair of leg here, this is the metathoracic leg. There is what is called pollen basket. This is a basket where the pollen grains are stored when they visit different flowers. So, we are looking into now economically important insect. This is what is called Apis. Apis is the scientific name of honeybee. And here, this is the silkworm. You can make out, this is the big one, larger one. This is the female and this is the male. Male. So, these are silkworms and scientific name is Bombyx. Bombyx is the scientific name, right? So this is what lac insect, we call a lacifer. Lacifers are the lac insects, the female of which secrete lac. Female of lac insect secrete lac, a substance used in the preparation of shellac. That is a resin used as a wood finish, wax, etc. For preparation of wood finish or wax, etc., this is used. So, shellac. So, this is the lacifer, lac insect. So, all these three, what you have studied, are the examples for economically important insects. Now, let us look into the vectors. Vectors are the one which always carry disease-causing organisms from the diseased organism to the normal individual. So, anopheles vectors. This is what mosquito have, anopheles mosquito. You know, anopheles mosquito is responsible for causing malaria. Malaria fever is caused by a one-celled parasite called Plasmodium. Female anopheles mosquitoes pick up the parasite from the infected people when they bite to obtain blood needed to nurture their eggs. When they bite the infected person, at that time they get this Plasmodium, that is the protozoan parasite, and they carry that, and when they bite another healthy person, they inject that Plasmodium into the body of healthy person. So here, anopheles is the vector which causes disease-causing organism, here Plasmodium, from infected individual to healthy individual. This is another one, another mosquito, and this mosquito is called Culex mosquito. The Culex mosquito is known to cause elephantiasis, or what you say, filariasis. So, it is also known as lymphatic filariasis. It's a very rare condition that is spread by Culex mosquito. So, Culex mosquito is responsible for elephantiasis, just like anopheles mosquito is responsible for malarial fever. This is one more mosquito called Aedes mosquito. Aedes mosquito is the one which always carry this virus which causes dengue fever or chikungunya. Aedes is the one which is also responsible for yellow fever. Aedes mosquito, the yellow fever mosquito, is a mosquito that can spread dengue fever and also chikungunya. So, these three are the most important vectors that you have. And this is what locust. Locust is otherwise called locusta, commonly called grasshoppers, and this is a gregarious pest. Gregarious means group living. You might have read in the news and all, whenever they come in millions and they attack the crop feed. This is Limulus. Already have mentioned about that. It is called horseshoe crab or king crab, and it is Limulus. And this is an example for living fossil. What is a living fossil? A living fossil is the organism which has not undergone much change during the course of several millions of years of evolution. So, generally during evolution, the organism gets changed. But Limulus, even though it lived for several millions of years, during these several millions of years, it has not showed changes in its body structure. Therefore, it is always called living fossil. So, Limulus is an example for living fossil. So, with this, we have completed Annelida and also Arthropoda. Now, it is the time for us to study the phylum Mollusca. If Arthropoda is the largest phylum, the phylum Mollusca is the second largest phylum. Mollusca is the second largest phylum in the animal kingdom, right? So, this is what example you have. This is the Mollusca member called Pila. Pila is also called a temple snail, apple snail. It is the one which is known to occur both in water and on land. It is found in fresh water. It is found in both water and on land, or it is also called amphibious mollusca. Amphibious means which has the ability or which has the capability to live both in water and on land. And this is the example, what is called octopus. Octopus is commonly called a devil fish, and you know, it lives in seawater. Molluscs are terrestrial or aquatic, marine or freshwater, having organ system level of organization. I said terrestrial. Which is the one you can give example for terrestrial? You can give the example of a pila. Pila is also terrestrial. Or Eudocamacus. Another molluscan member, mostly seen on land, and it does not possess any shell on the body, what we call a slug, S-L-U-G. Slug is shellless mollusca. So, you have terrestrial molluscs like pila or temple snail or apple snail or slug, S-L-U-G. Slug is the molluscan member without a shell. Or they may be aquatic. Most of them are aquatic. Most of the members are aquatic. And most of them are marine. Or few, just like that of the pila as a freshwater, having organ system level of organization. They are bilaterally symmetrical, triploblastic, and coelomate animals. Bilaterally symmetrical, triploblastic, and coelomate animals. You know the terms very well. Body is covered by calcareous shell. What you see here, this is of the pila, snail, pila. And this is the shell, and it is a coiled shell made up of single piece, one piece. Okay, coiled shell. Body is covered by a calcareous shell, calcium carbonate made shell. Body is covered by a calcareous shell and is unsegmented. Shell is a body is unsegmented here. So, in case of arthropoda, you have seen body is segmented. In case of annelida, you have seen body segmented. But in case of mollusca, body is unsegmented and it is divisible into head region, muscular foot, and visceral hump. There is a raised viscera, body part inside. It is in the form of hump, what you call visceral hump. Viscera refers to inner body parts. Hump is a raised part here. So, we have viscera, which is arranged in the form of hump, visceral hump. So, body is divisible into head, muscular foot, and visceral hump. Same thing, pila. And as I told you, snail, pila is amphibious. It lives in water as well as on land. When it lives on land, it can take air, it can breathe atmospheric air by an aperture or through an aperture, what is called pneumostome. Pneumo refers to air, stome refers to aperture for the intake and exit of the air. The soft and spongy layer of skin forms a mantle over the visceral hump. As I told you, body can be divisible into head region. It can be divisible into foot region, and we have the viscera. This is what the internal part of the body. Internal part of the body together, it is referred as viscera. And this viscera or visceral hump is covered by shell. This is what you have, the shell. This is the shell. But in between the shell and viscera, there is what is called the mantle. You can see the mantle. So, a soft, spongy layer of skin forms a mantle or called a mantle, it covers the visceral hump. So, above the visceral hump, there is a mantle. And this mantle secretes the outer shell. The shell, what you have here, the shell is secreted by the mantle. Mantle covers the entire visceral mass, right? The space between the hump, this is the hump, visceral hump, the space between the visceral hump and the mantle, this is the mantle. The space between the mantle and visceral hump is called mantle cavity. And in this mantle cavity, we have feather-like gills. Please remember, the feather-like gills, whatever the gill that you come across in mollusca, it is also known as tenidium or plural tenidia. So, there are feather-like gills These are also termed tinnidia. C-T-E-N-I-D-I-A. Tinnidia. And these tinnidia not only help in the respiration, they also help in excretion. Very important point. Molluscan gills not only help in the respiration, they are also helpful in excretory function. Very, very important point. Generally, you know, gills are used in respiration. But in case of molluscs, gills are also helpful in excretory function. Very important point to be noted. And gills are also otherwise called tinnidia. The anterior head region has a sensory tentacles. This is what you have the head region. So, anterior head region is a sensory tentacle. I already showed you the sensory tentacles. So, these are the sensory tentacles. At the tip of, there are two pairs of tentacles, four tentacles, shorter one and longer one. At the tip of this tentacle, you do come across eye, presence of eye. So, the anterior head region has a sensory tentacles. The mouth contains a file-like organ. This is what you have. Mouth has on the inner side a special organ, and this special organ is called radula. And this radula is helpful in feeding because it works as a rasping organ, just to scrape. So, the mouth contains a file-like rasping organ. Rasping organ is organ for scraping, to remove the food from the attached surface. So, the mouth contains a file-like rasping organ with a somewhat a tooth-like structure there. And this rasping organ is called a radula, and it is helpful in feeding. So, another important point you have to remember here is that all molluscs member, they possess a radula, or they possess radula-like structure. Molluscs are usually dioecious. That means sexes are separate. You can see here, this is one of this snail. This is another snail. You can see coiled shell snail. So, they are usually dioecious. Sexes are separate, unisexual. And oviparous, that means they lay eggs with indirect development. They show indirect development. When you say that they show indirect development, we should come across the larval forms. Which are the larval forms? The larval forms include trochophore, veliger, and glaucidium. These are the three larval forms that we have in mollusca. Trochophore larva, veliger larva, and glaucidium larva. Glaucidium larva, these are the three larvae. Trochophore larval name you have heard in annelida also. Yes. Annelida also has a trochophore larva, and this mollusk also has a trochophore larva. And you must remember that annelids only gave rise to molluscs. Annelids, on the other hand, they gave rise to arthropods. Okay. So, trochophore larva you encounter both in annelida and in case of the mollusca. These are the examples. Now, let us see these examples one by one. This is a pila, also called apple snail. What you have to remember is that the shell, coiled shell, is made up of single piece. There is only one piece, single piece. Shell is made up of single piece. And these all single-shelled coiled animals belong to a class called gastropoda. Gastropoda, this is the pila apple snail. And this is pearl oyster. Pinctada, you can see the pearl there inside. It is with the two valves, two shell valves. Pearl oyster belongs to the Pinctada, or its scientific name is Pinctada. And this is sepia. Sepia is otherwise called, commonly called cuttlefish, because this mollusca has no shell on the outer side. There is no shell on the outer body surface. There is no shell. On the other hand, you would come across a shell internally. And this shell, which is present internally, is called cuttlebone. So, remember, sepia has internal shell. It has internal shell, and this internal shell is called cuttlebone. So, they have shell like this. Very light, feather light, quite light, feather light. Okay. So sepia is called cuttlefish because they have in their body a light shell called cuttle bone. This is a loligo squid. Squid. This has no shell. Loligo, otherwise commonly called squid. And this is what you have, octopus. Octopus are the molluscs with 8 arms. You can see 8 arms here. Octo refers to 8. 8 arms, and octopus is commonly called a devil fish. Devil fish. Common name is devil fish. There are 8 arms, right? 8 arms. Octo refers to 8. Octopus is the devil fish. And in this octopus, and also in say case of sepia, loligo, etc., they all possess what is called ink sac. Whenever they are disturbed, they release some ink from their body, make the water to get colored, turbid with the color there, and escape from the enemy. Escape from the enemy. It is their defensive mechanism. Like that, here you have. This is what aplysia. It's called aplysia. It is commonly called sea hare. Look here. This appears like the ears of the hare, rabbit. So it is also called a sea slug. It has no shell. It is a shellless mollusk. I already told you, shellless mollusk are always called a slug. So since it is found in the sea, it is called a sea slug. Or it is also called a sea hare. And it is this called aplysia. Scientific name is aplysia. And this is also known to release colored fluid whenever it is threatened, and then escapes. By the time water gets cleared, it escapes from the site and moves far away. This is dentalium. And dentalium is commonly called a tusk shell. Tusk shell or dentalium. And this you have Chetopleura, commonly called chiton. This is one with the 8 pieces of shells. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So it is the chiton or Chetopleura. So these are all some of the examples for the mollusca. And now we have to look into the next phylum, that is phylum Echinodermata. Echinodermata, these are the animals, they have spine in their skin. Therefore, they are called spiny-bodied animals. Spiny-bodied animals. So, these animals have an endoskeleton. Remember, it is not exoskeleton, it is endoskeleton. These animals have an endoskeleton of a calcareous ossicle, made up of calcium carbonate. Calcareous ossicles, hence the name Echinodermata, spiny-bodied animals. This is what the diagrams you have in your NCERT book. This is a starfish, scientifically called Asterias. And this is a brittle star, and it is scientifically called Ophiura. Ophiura or brittle star, and this is the starfish. Now let us study some characters pertaining to the Echinodermata. This is the Asterias or starfish as seen in its nature, natural habitat, starfish. This is Ophiura, brittle star. They have 5 arms, and this is the central disc, brittle star. One of the most important features with regard to Echinodermata is that they are all marine with the organ system level of organization. All are marine. You have seen Tenophora. In Tenophora, you have seen all are marine. And after Tenophora, it is the Echinodermata to have all members which are living in seawater. One of the most important features here is that the adult echinoderms are radially symmetrical, but the larvae are bilaterally symmetrical. Adult echinoderms are radially symmetrical. This is what adult echinoderm, you can cut them along any axis, but it must pass through the center, and therefore they are radially symmetrical, that too pentaradially symmetrical. penta radially symmetrical. All the body parts are arranged along the different radii. And these are, adults are radially symmetrical, whereas the larvae are bilaterally symmetrical. You can cut the larva body into two equal halves. Very important feature. Then, they are triploblastic and coelomate animals. You know the meaning of this. Digestive system is complete. Look here, this is starfish. And this surface, it always touches the sand below, and this surface will be above. So this is dorsal, and this is ventral, and this surface, which is touching the ground, is known as oral surface, because it has mouth there. The other surface, opposite to the surface, where mouth is present, is the oral surface. Opposite to the oral surface, the other surface is called aboral, A-B-O-R-A-L. Aboral means opposite to oral. Suppose this is the starfish. This surface touches the ground. So this is oral and opposite surface is aboral. So digestive system is complete with the mouth on the lower or ventral side and anus on the upper side. So here you can make a summary, anus, and here is the mouth. And this is not anus. What you see here, this is not anus. This is an important structure called madreporite. I will tell you about that later. Okay. The most distinctive feature of echinoderm is the presence of water vascular system, also known as ambulacral system. Water vascular system or ambulacral system, which helps in locomotion, capture and transport of food and respiration. You have already heard water canal system. Water canal system is seen in porifera. Water vascular system is seen in the echinoderms. So the most important feature of echinoderms is the presence of water vascular system, which helps in locomotion, that means the movement, capture and transport of food, and also respiration. Let us see that. So what you see here, this is what parts of water vascular system. Or water vascular system is also known as ambulacral system. A-M-B-U-L-A-C-R-A-L. Ambulacral system, or it is also known as a water vascular system. What happens in the water vascular system is, as I already showed you in the previous slide, see, this is a button-like structure. So through this button-like structure, this surface is present on the upper surface. Through this button-like structure, water enters in. Water enters in through this button-like structure. So, one, this button-like structure is called madreporite. Through the madreporite, water enters in. It comes to now what is called stone canal. From the stone canal, water comes to this ring canal. From the ring canal, it enters into radial canal. These are all radial canals along the radius, radial canal. From the radial canal, it comes to the lateral canal. From the lateral canal, it enters into the tube feet. Tube feet. Tube foot. This tube foot is a singular, tube feet plural. Tube feet are otherwise called podia. P-O-D-I-A. So, when water comes through the madreporite, stone canal, ring canal, radial canal, lateral canal, and it enters into the tube feet, the foot part, what you see here, these feet part, they elongate. They elongate and they attach to substratum and the entire body is pulled. Therefore, water vascular system helps in movement, helps in locomotion. So, water vascular system helps in locomotion. Capture and transport of food. What does it mean? Capture and transport of food. Look here. Here, this is what a starfish, and this is the shell, sea water shell. And to the shell, it is a molluscan member, shell. The tube feet, they attach. The tube feet attach to the shell and force it to open. So, when more hundreds of tube feet attach, podia attach, and pull from outside, the shell opens. When the shell opens, the animal, starfish, it pushes its stomach out and feeds on the shell, feeds on the animal contained in the shell. Therefore, water vascular system helps in the locomotion, helps in collection of the food, and it also helps in respiration. Excretory system is absent. Sexes are separate. You have male and female. Reproduction is sexual. Fertilization is usually external. Eggs and sperms are released to the water and their fertilization takes place. Development is indirect with the free swimming larva. So you have 5 different types of larvae. What is this, what you see here? Bipinnaria larva or brachiolaria larva. This bipinnaria and brachiolaria are the larvae of starfish. They are the larvae of starfish like that. You have Echinopolytis larva, another type of larva, larva of a brittle star. Like that, you have Ophioplotus larva, Echinopolytis larva, sorry, this is Ophioplotus larva. Ophioplotus larva. Ophioplotus larva is the larva of a brittle star. And this is Echinopolytis larva. Echinopolytis larva is the larva of sea urchin. Larva of a sea urchin. Echinopolytis larva. Sea urchin is called Echinus. So here, this is Opio, not Echino. Ophioplotus larva of a brittle star. Brittle star is Ophiura. Ophiura is a brittle star. So Ophioplotus larva. This is Echinopolytis larva of sea urchin. And this is Auricularia larva of sea cucumber. Holothurites, sea cucumber. And you have here Doliolaria larva of crinoids, antedon. So each of the different types of animals have different larvae in the echinoderms. So remember, Bipinnaria, Brachiolaria, Ophioplotus, Echinopolytus, then Doliolaria, Auricularia larva. So, now let us see the examples. These are the examples. Asterias, starfish. This is a sea urchin. You can see all the pointed structures. Okay, spines. Spines arising from the tubercle, sea urchin, echinus. And this is antedon. Antedon or sea lily, commonly called sea lily, it is always found attached to the substratum. All others are free living, but antedon is a sessile. It is found attached to one or the other object, sea lily. And here, sea cucumber, cucumeria. This is called sea cucumber, cucumeria. And here, Ophiura, it is called brittle star, Ophiura. And here, this is what you have, antedon, same, feather star, sea lily, so beautiful here. They are with the 10 arms and all. So this is a antedon or feather star or sea lily. So that's all about today's class. We shall meet in the next class. Okay, thank you very much.
Welcome to Sushruta app. In this video we are going to demo NEET topics and its related resources from slides and videos. Kindly give all the necessary permission and proceed to the main screen. Let us select Biology 11th as our subject. This will open up the syllabus for this subject. All the syllabus data regarding the subject will be loaded at this stage. Once the process is complete, the icon will be active. Zoom a bit so that the topics are clearly visible and click on the orange highlighter button. This will open up a selection box. Adjust the box so that it covers the topic you are interested in. Once this is done, confirm your selection by clicking on the green button. This will download the slides resources for that unit. Once the download is complete, it will ask you for the permission to download the textbooks from the NCERT site. Once the download is complete, it will open up the chapter and the subchapter hierarchy for the unit. Select one of the subchapter. In this case, I am selecting the first subchapter. It will load all the resources pertaining to that topic. Let us click the second icon, that is textbook. You will be given an option if there are many resources. Now you can see, it has directly taken us to the page of the selected topic. Click on the small green button to load all the icons back. Similarly, let us select the third icon, that is slides. It will open up the slides for the said topic. Finally, let us select the third icon, that is YouTube videos. This will show the videos related to the topic from IIT Pal. If there are more than one video, select any one of the links and watch the video. Similarly, let us select another topic and follow the same procedure. Remember, downloading of slides is a one-time process per unit. Slides are being downloaded here, as we have visited this unit for the first time. The next time we visit the same unit, slides will be retrieved locally. We can also select a topic from slides and get its equivalent matching resource. In this case, I am selecting the topic, taxonomic categories, and getting its equivalent topic from the textbook. So here we have the textbook resource showing taxonomic categories. When there are too many topics selected, or the topic name match is not found, the list of entire topics will be shown to the student. He can select any one topic and proceed further. Let's click on the Moodle icon, seen on the syllabus screen. This will take you to the Moodle calendar, where you will be able to view all the scheduled events. Let us click on one of the events. There is an event for Biology Unit 1. On clicking it, we'll give a live lecture Google Meet link in it. Clicking on the link will directly open up Google Meet app where the lecture will be taken. Let us select a topic from the biology syllabus and proceed further. Now let us click the first icon, that is Gyan Chat. Gyan Chat is a medium where the students can interact with the other students via channels. Each subject unit will be having its own dedicated channel. Students can share their doubts or thoughts via this channel. Dion Moodle would directly take you to the course material for that particular unit. These course materials will be uploaded on Moodle by the lectures. Now let us try out a different subject, that is physics. Let us click the textbook icon and select the second option. This will open up a message box displaying the page number of the Kindle version of HC Verma book. On clicking OK, it will open up the Kindle app with the book loaded. Once the book is loaded, click on the hamburger icon on the top and select the Go To option. This opens up a dialog box asking you to enter the page number. Enter the same page number, which was shown to you earlier, and click OK. This will directly take you to the page related to the topic you selected. Now let us see the formula sheet for physics. Formula sheet is provided to get a quick reference of all the formulas covered in the syllabus. If you want to refer to a topic from the formula sheet, simply select the topic and proceed further. We are also providing a link to the CEngage app. On clicking the CEngage icon, it will open the CEngage app. You will find all the test material inside My Bookshelf option. Finally, you can take the mock tests using the National Test Appeals app. Clicking on the icon will take you directly to the National Test Appeals app, where you can try out mock tests. Whenever a QR code is found inside the textbook, the student can select the QR code and he will be provided with e-content material. In this particular case, we have contents related to text PDF. In some cases, there will be video content, graphic and interactive content. Let us see how video content would look like from a different chapter.
Hello, my dear students. Very glad to meet you all. I am Professor G.K. Bhatt. In 2018, or during 2018 to 2020, I got an opportunity to visit nearly 25 institutions, and I used to teach in all these institutions biology, preparing the students for NEET exam. For NEET exam, you must be thorough with each and every word given in the NCERT book. That means biology, you have to by heart the NCERT book. Not simply by heart, understanding the concept and by heart. That is what is expected. Now let us start with this particular chapter, that is Animal Kingdom. And we shall look into the various components that is given here in the NCERT, in the Animal Kingdom chapter. Under basis of classification, what we are looking what characters, what points you are making to classify the animals. That is what we are studying under basis of classification. In spite of differences in structure and form of different animals, there are a lot of differences in the structure, in their form, gross morphology. There are certain fundamental features common to various individuals. In relation to arrangement of cells, body symmetry, nature of coelom, patterns of digestive system, circulatory system, or respiratory.
We also have live lectures by world-class and dedicated tutors.
Well, that's all for this demo. Thanks for watching.